Hi everyone, welcome to the next in our series of Web Analytics Rapid Question Fire.
Yep.
And my name is Avinash.
And I'm Nick.
And we're going to go back to our questions that you had submitted on the Dory page. Thank you so much for doing that. And thanks especially to those of you who voted, because we can't answer all of the questions that you ask, but your votes help us figure out which are the top most important questions to you. And those are the ones we're going to try and address. So, Nick, you have the first question?
I did. And it's actually a repeat from last time where we were asked a question and we got confused and we didn't actually answer it. So the question was, what's a good strategy for tracking non-bounced, non-converted users?
Sure, sure. So this is a good question. And typically what I do is, there's a lot of focus on figuring out why people bounce. And that's good. Send that away. We also have a lot of focus on figuring out which people convert and what happens. That's great, put them away. But the core idea here is to say, if you do stay on our website, but then you don't convert, what is the value you add? And there, the idea that I recommend is to focus on the macro and micro conversion concept. Just go to my blog and search for micro conversions. You'll find the blog post. And essentially what I say is, the macro conversion is like getting an order on officemax.com or getting a lead on barackobama.com. That's great, macro conversion. But then if people are not doing that conversion, what you want to figure out is, are they adding any other value to our business? Mm-hmm. And in this case, on barackobama.com, for example, it could be that you printed the letter that you're going to hold up for protests, or you signed up to do something else, or you did another thing. On officemax.com, micro conversions for non-converting, non-bouncing visitors could be that I printed a map from my house to the store. It could be that on officemax.com I submitted a lead. I signed up for an RSS feed. I looked at X, Y, Z things or ordered a catalog. Mm-hmm. For them, it's important to order catalogs. So the short answer is, for people who are not meeting the macro conversion criteria and people who are not bouncing, figure out if what the micro conversions are on your website and if those people are doing those micro conversions, because all of that action and offline revenue is still being done on the website and that is still of value to your business. So focus on the micro conversions.
That's great. And I think it's a good plug too that we just in our new launch released engagement metrics. So
that's
now
exactly
you can
right.
set goals for people for how much time you've spent on a site. So if you spend more than 2 minutes, that might be an engagement goal. Or if you spend more than 5 pages per visit, you've really interacted with content. And that can be set as a goal as well.
Exactly. For many websites, branding websites, micro sites, flash only, movie websites, things like that, there really isn't much of a macro conversion at all. You know, you can't do anything on those macro sites. But you can say, if you come to our branding website and you spend X amount of time, that's a success. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what is enabled now in Google Analytics. And I think it's a great idea. So
good.
Let me ask Nick a question here from our latest round. And the question is from Segito. And it says, how to graph the volume of different keywords in time? That's a good question, Nick.
It's a good question.
API?
Yeah, I think there's no report that actually does that. What you can do is for every single date, you see the total count of keywords. It gets really tedious to export that or to look at every date and the total number of keywords. With the API, you can create custom reports.
Exactly.
You can do really cool things. So hopefully, Segito, we can expect to see some exciting reports from you guys with the API.
You can look at the volume over time for a single keyword.
Yeah.
But you can't look at it like that, your top 10 keywords. Mm-hmm. Use the API. And Nick has already written blog posts to Excel plugins that mm-hmm. plug into Google Analytics. Perhaps you can add links at the bottom of this particular video.
Absolutely.
So you guys just go read those posts by Nick and use those Excel plugins to pull the data, and you can plot it in Excel very easily. So.
Right. Once it's in Excel, you can do the countings, the aggregations, any sort of formulas you can apply to it.
We'll add links.
Great.
Another question for you, Nick. This is from Jan Mengsky from the Czech Republic. Mm-hmm. Hello, Czech Republic. On e-commerce site, eShop, should I track conversions also like a goal? Are there some benefits? This is a good one.
It's a good question.
So to clarify, Nick, I think what Jan is saying is you can have e-commerce tracking in Google Analytics mm-hmm. or you can use goals tracking, which are completely different things. Mm-hmm. Should we track e-commerce conversions using the goals goals feature rather than the e-commerce feature?
Yeah, and I think it's definitely, you only get more data if you actually track it as a goal. For example, when people will go through your checkout process, there's a couple steps. With Google Analytics, you can actually define each of the different steps that lead into a goal. And so for a checkout process, you can define abandonment rates. So how many people who went from step A actually made it to step B, and then how many people actually fell out of that, you know, process. You can only do that with goals, and so it's valuable to set up that final e-commerce transaction as a goal in Google Analytics.
Right, but we wouldn't do it as an alternative to e-commerce tracking. Like I think that Jan has to use, for e-shops, he has to track conversions using e-commerce tracking because he's going to get a lot more reports.
Right.
And average order size and days and visits to conversion
revenue,
and all of those kinds
exactly.
of things. So you have to have Jan e-commerce tracking. But what Nick is astutely referring to is the funnel conversion and all of those funnel reports, and those you can track using goals. So
right.
it's an and situation, not an or situation.
Yep.
Good.
Great. So question for you, Avinash. So here is Jonas from Sweden. I have looked at an old blog entry on the Google Analytics blog from Monday, January 1st, 2007.
Wow.
I wonder if there is any way to see the first time and prior visitors for absolute unique visitors. I have not found this in Analytics.
Right. And I think, Jonas, we simply crossed wires by a week here. You probably asked us a question prior to the announcements made at the summit last week.
Mm-hmm.
But as of this week, you should be able to do this using the absolute visitor unique visitor tracking
mm-hmm.
in Google Analytics. You should be able to do that. We'll add a link to a video about the absolute unique visitor tracking capability in Google Analytics.
Mm-hmm.
It was just released last week, so don't worry about it. But please use that feature, and you should be able to create segments, custom reports in order to do just this.
Absolutely.
Good
and,
question.
Currently, it's being rolled out in a phased approach.
Yeah.
So hopefully, you'll get that sooner than later in your
very,
account.
Very, in a few
yeah.
days. Yeah.
Absolutely. Great. Another question for you.
Mm-hmm.
This time it's from Shalendra Dubev from Indore, India. Can I see the first, second, and third and subsequent landing pages and exit pages for a specific keyword?
So I think that what Shalendra is asking for is path analysis for keyword reports.
Mm-hmm.
And Google Analytics does not do path analysis. And I am quite proud of it because I think path analysis is a complete waste of time.
Okay.
It just is too macro and very few people follow the same path, and it ends up being a waste of time. For unstructured experiences, because there will be such a fragmentation of paths that you can't actually find insights, path analysis is good for structured analysis, where let's say you go from add to cart, start checkout, billing page, shipping page, credit card page, checkout. That's a structured process. In that case, path analysis is okay. But for other things, path analysis is deceptively useless. So be aware of it. But in Google Analytics, what you can track is that landing pages for keywords, easily available.
Yes.
Absolutely available. The other thing is, if you go into the content report, there's a wonderful report called Navigation Summary.
Mm-hmm.
If you click on that, what it will say, show you is all the people who start on this page, what is the next page they see,
mm-hmm.
and where do they end up? Regardless if they went from A, B, C, D, E, F,
mm-hmm.
or they went from A, P, M, Q, E, F, regardless of how they ended up on page F, you'll be able to see where people ended up, which says that all we know is if you start on this page, click on a link on this page, does that link get the person to the final page that is desirable to us, regardless of how they chose the path? You know, we're doing democracy, and we're saying no more communism and forcing you down a particular path.
Right.
You know, it's democratic, you can go anywhere, but we still do want you to end up at this goal path,
mm-hmm.
goal page we have. You can certainly do that. Look at the navigation summary report in content. For the landing pages, look at the landing pages report in content. You can do both of those by keywords. And those kinds of analysis will be super productive in helping you figure out how to do better SEO and how to do better PPC.
Yep.
So that's a good question. Here's one for you, Nick.
Okay.
And it's from Jonathan in Connecticut. And Jonathan asks, I have but one question. Whoa. I'm not a vendor with my own website. As an affiliate, can I use Google Analytics to help me?
I have but one answer, and that's yes.
Yeah,
it's a free product, of course. You can use it on any of your sites. Just sign up at our site, and you can use it.
Exactly. The only tips I might add, and maybe Nick has some tips, is if you have an affiliate website, make sure that you encode your exit links that are leaving. and use either an on-click tracking methodology or a page view creation methodology in order to capture all of those leads that you're sending to the final place from your lead gen website. That way, Google Analytics can do even more productive analysis. Yep. So this whole idea that the one extra thing you'll have to do is an excellent feature in Google Analytics is this exit tracking. Mm-hmm. We'll add a link to a help article for exit tracking.
Set up, yep.
And Jonathan, you're going to have so much fun with this feature and make a lot more money as an affiliate.
There you go. Okay. So a question for you now, Avinash. I have two small specialized blogs that generate some traffic, but not much. Is there a way to exclude the gazillion times I view my own site from my GA stats?
Oh, of course. Absolutely, you can do that. There is a very simple methodology called IP exclusion. And what it does is you go into Google Analytics, the admin settings, mm-hmm. and you actually just put the first 7 digits of your IP address. Mm-hmm. You don't have to put the last if you don't want to. And it will actually exclude all of the hits, if you will, that you are creating. It's actually very easy to do, and we'll also add a link to the help article. That's probably the best method, right?
Yep, that sounds good.
So we'll ask our last question for the day, mm-hmm. and the last question is for you, Nick.
Okay.
And it's from Sudhir in California. Yay, California. I have 10 different websites, different URLs, and shopping cart installed at store.example.com from Cleverbridge. What is the best strategy to track my sales completed on the store.example.com by my various campaigns? And that's a good question. So essentially, this person set up a plethora of websites. Mm-hmm. They all have their own domains. But if you check out, you check out from the same website. Mm-hmm. That's the structure they have, which is actually very common. Many mm-hmm. people use a common shopping cart, like a PayPal checkout.
Right,
that's kind of the scenario here. Mm-hmm. Where the Cleverbridge is providing the checkout functionality, mm-hmm. but this person has a number of websites, and they Sudhir wants to track conversions mm-hmm. from all these websites, but from that central facility. So how do you do that in Google Analytics, Nick?
That's a great question. This is a very similar integration that we did with Google Checkout, so we can talk about that, and you can use this experience in your own environments. So what happens is when you come to a site, you're tracked by using a cookie, and that cookie information has your campaign, your visitor ID, and so forth. That cookie is actually called a first-party cookie, and it's tied to the domain. So you have many different domains. Each of them will have their own visitor ID mm-hmm. and campaign and so forth. Mm-hmm. So the question is because it's tied to a domain, how do we get that cookie information from domain A to the shopping cart domain? Mm-hmm. And so we have a special method called get linker URL, and we'll put a link mm-hmm. of the technical part. And with that, when somebody exits to actually make the checkout and do the final purchase process, that information from the cookie gets put together and sent over to the URL, the final page. Then the final page, there's a little bit of code you set on there, so that way all the information from the cookie and the visitor ID get maintained on this other domain. And then when you start tracking and sending the e-commerce data to analytics, all the initial campaign referral information is maintained.
I see.
So it's a little bit technical, but it's very doable. We do it with Google Checkout with millions of people who use
PayPal.
That today.
PayPal too.
PayPal has that option as well.
Neva Merchants as well mm-hmm. is natively integrated with Google Analytics. Mm-hmm. So there are tons of these providers of shopping cart. I'm not sure about Cleverbridge, mm-hmm. so check with them, Sudhir. But this essentially is an amalgamation of cross-domain tracking
right.
and also third-party checkout, which you can completely do with Google Analytics. Mm-hmm. And Nick is going to add a link to this post.
Yep.
So thank you for all the questions. That was a good question.
Yeah.
So thanks, everyone. That's all for this week. Please do go to our Dory page, where you will see a link on this blog post as well as on the left nav in the YouTube channel. Please go there and vote for your favorite question so we can answer what's important to you or submit a question of your own. We thank you very much for listening, and let's have more analytics fun.
All right. See you.